To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in.
This is our second to last class that we have. That will be at 1 o'clock and 7 o'clock. So next Wednesday will be the last one, and then we'll do our 6 months at only 7 o'clock. So that'll be running April through the end of September. We used to do it, if you remember, with the time change, but it's always different, it seems like, every year. And it was always hard to keep track of, and we noticed as we got into middle of September that it would start to get dark by the time evening came, and a lot of times the time change didn't happen until November. So we were, you know, there was like a month where folks weren't coming to Bible class because they couldn't get out, and we hadn't changed it to the 1 o'clock time yet. So this works really well for the summer because we have guest speakers for 13, going to be 14 weeks this particular year. And it's going to be nice that they only have a 7 o'clock time instead of having to come in early during that time. But I know it's better for the congregation. They really like the 1 o'clock time. It's a little bit better for the preacher if he only has one time to preach. But it's not about the preacher. It's about the congregation. So that's what it's really about. In the month of March, we are speaking about the church and its people. We talked about Jesus as being the chief shepherd first before we took a look at the shepherds over the congregation, elders, overseers, bishops, deacons, or excuse me, elders and shepherds there. And then we looked at deacons after that. And then we're now switching gears here a little bit to take a look at the role of preachers and evangelists. On Sunday morning, Jim Schumann did a study on preachers, and you might be saying, well, isn't an evangelist the same thing? Well, yeah, pretty much. It just like we talk about, overseers or elders, they're two different Greek words, and they kind of describe the same role, but maybe different aspects of that particular role. And I think preacher, evangelist is along that line. They're used sort of interchangeably throughout the New Testament. But we can see that there is a little bit of difference in the direction of what it is that they would do within a local body. And that's what I'm hoping to be able to talk about a little bit today. It was good that we had a preacher speak about elders, and we had an elder speak about preachers on Sunday. So we got to not talk about ourselves, but be able to present it from a different perspective, perhaps. Here was our passage on Sunday morning. Our main passage, it says, but as for you, teach what accords with sound doctrine. Paul is speaking to the young evangelists in his pastoral letters to Timothy and to Titus, Timothy in Ephesus, Titus in the island of Crete. And he's telling them to organize the churches that are being formed throughout like the island of Crete or the area of Ephesus. And make sure that you appoint elders in each of the towns where you are. There's a big need for shepherding, leadership. But what really is the role that a preacher or evangelist plays within the Lord's church to make sure that the spiritual family, the household of God, is getting the right information to be able to make disciples and lead everybody to heaven? That's really what we're all about here. And so as Paul here is speaking to Titus in this particular passage and Timothy in the passage, our main passage today, we can see that they're very similar in their sounds here. Teach what accords with sound doctrine. This is so important for the Lord's church, especially today in the current environment that we live in. It seems like opinion is preached so many different places that the idea that you could have some kind of spiritual thought, a revelation, and you develop a church body around it. You know, you go get yourself a place where people can meet, and suddenly your focus is on service, or perhaps it's on some other aspect of church life where we're reaching out to a particular demographic, working with them, and you know, that's what they build their church on. But we're told here, teach what accords with sound doctrine. So important. And then after that, we've got instructions for older men, older women, and younger men, and how it is that they are to be taught what they are to be doing for life. And so this gives us a clue for preachers and or evangelists as to what it is we're supposed to be doing. It's not just being students of the Word. That's what they do in universities, right? You've got some, stuffy old professor that's, you know, hasn't been out of his office in about 6 years, and all he does is sit there and read his books. And he learns a lot, but he doesn't take that information and teach it in a way to others that they can apply it to their lives and be better because of it. You see, preachers, evangelists, God designed for them to be able to train others in all these things. Why? That the Word of God may not be reviled. There's something there that says we need to teach truth, and we need to make sure others understand that truth in the way in which we teach it, so that they apply it to their lives, they're living it out in their lives, people see it, and they're not going to turn around and revile the Word of God because of that. It says, show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. There's an example that a minister, a teacher, a preacher, an evangelist needs to be living out in his life. And in your teaching, show integrity, dignity, and sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. One of the things that happens out in the world is people who don't know that there's any difference between the Lord's body and copycats that are out there that are following their own wills and doctrines and so forth, they think that when they see some kind of corruption or some kind of immorality or something going on, that maybe these televangelists that you see all the time, and they're falls from grace. And people will see that, and they'll turn around and apply that to the Lord's body, and that's not the model that God has given us to follow and live by. So, as we take a look here about elders, we see the elders are also preachers. One of the things that elders must have is they must be able to teach, it says there in 1 Timothy chapter 3. Or apt to teach, as some translations say. They need to have that ability, not just to know information, but be able to work with their flock that they are leading and that they're shepherding in such a way that they're able to understand what truth is and understand the difference between that and other ideas that might be bombarding them. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, it says, let elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. So although elders are able to teach and are called on sometimes to teach, that's not their main role. Their main role is shepherding the flock. But there are some who do a double duty here, and they are able to shepherd the flock, but they're also able to truly do it with the ministry of the Word that they are about, and being able to preach and teach. For the Scripture says, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain, and the laborer deserves his wages. It is a spiritual institution, the church is. It's a group that is the household of God in the midst of a very physical world. And so the ministry of the Word is absolutely essential, that if we don't get anything else, we need to make sure that we are holding fast to truth. And this is why preachers, evangelists are so important. about elders. We're saying here that we do not admit a charge against an elder except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. As for those who persist in sin, rebuke them in the presence of all, so that the rest may stand in fear. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus and of the elect angels, I charge you, Timothy says, to keep these, Paul says to Timothy, I charge you to keep these rules without prejudging, doing nothing from partiality. Do not be hasty in the laying on of hands, nor take part in the sins of others. Keep yourself pure. So, Paul, when he wants to emphasize something, he will do it with phrases like this. He's talking to the young evangelist Timothy, or he's talking to the young evangelist Titus, and he'll say a phrase like that, I charge you. Like, look, this is so important. You've got to get what I am saying here, that the Lord's church is going to be attacked spiritually. They're going to want to drift off into error because the pagan world is so strong and pushing in on them all the time that you have to hold up the word of God. They've got to know what that is and see the difference between truth and what the rest of the world is trying to get them to follow, which is a much easier path, a broader path that leads to destruction. And so you've got to, I charge you, and we're going to see this in our main passage here as well. If we're not to be hasty in the laying on of hands for elders, that's a lot like the deacons. Remember, they had to be tested before they could serve, and they had to be spiritual men as well. God and his organization of the church wants spiritually minded men because it's a spiritual organization in order to lead everybody to heaven. Elders are members of one body too, of course. So I want to start out with a story here. When we were talking about elders, I mentioned that Alfred and I were elders from the middle of 2016 all the way to the end of 2020, and so about 4.5 years there. I was receiving all kinds of funds and support from various churches in Texas and Arizona, Alabama, Tennessee, Ohio, and I would make support trips every 2 to 3 years and meet with elders, mission committee members, and so forth, and give a report on the work. Of course, I was doing monthly reports as well and all of this. But this is the tale of two elders who are a preacher and an evangelist. Try to understand the difference here between the two. I was doing both roles, preacher and evangelist, probably working about 50 hours a week. It was tough work up there. It was constant. It was all the time. Sometimes you get a little downtime, but then the phone rings and you're the only one, right? So what do you do? You know, you're trying to work with all kinds of people and set up studies with them, do visitation. You're teaching private studies, but you're also organizing and teaching classes and getting ready sermons and so forth. You're the youth director. You're the you're the one who visits all the nursing homes. You're doing everything. And early 2019, my wife, who had gone off chemo and radiation in September of 18. Says, I don't think I'm going to be able to work in the fall. I think you need to take a job that has health insurance. Whew. What do I do? You know, how does a, I probably was, 48 at the time. Was I just to, try to go knock on the door of the school, local school, and say, hey, I'd like to be your next English teacher. Who wants to hire a 48-year-old guy, you know, who's been out of education for, you know, quite a few years? What was I to do? I found a job working for a non-medical transport company, meaning not like an ambulance, but one that would pick up people in wheelchairs, walkers, and so forth, take them to doctor's appointments. And a lot of times, I realized that I could go to, say, Burlington, Vermont, across Lake Champlain, with somebody in a wheelchair, and I would, you know, get them into their appointment. Then I'd have 2 hours to wait. I'd be sitting out in the truck for 2 hours. What could I do with that time? So I bought this tray here, and one side you can put food on it, but the other side's flat, and it fits on the steering wheel, and you put a laptop on it, and I had laptop would travel. So I could work on a lesson while I'm sitting in the parking lot waiting for the, you know, the ding on my phone to say that she's ready, and I could pull up to the front and go get her. So this kind of thing worked out really well, but what it did was it took away a lot of my flexible time, my time where I could go and do visits and work with families and kids and so forth. And I realized this. What happened there? I'm sure something happened. And so I said, well, I will keep my outside support because those churches are investing in me as the figure up there in Plattsburgh. But the Plattsburgh support, the money that the church there was giving me, I said I would give to Alfred. I would let him have that money that came from Plattsburgh, and that he would become the evangelist. He would be the one who had the flexible time. He was getting older. He was working factories all his life, and his body was starting to wear out quite a bit, and he needed a change. And so this was really good for him. And so he's got a very personable guy, and he could do, you know, those visits and do all hours of the night and whatever else while I'm, you know, the minister of the word and the preacher that could work on lessons and get all those things done. So my time was more rigid. I had a laptop. I could travel. But his time was flexible. There was a lot of variation in his schedule, and he could do that, and we could still get together and have a meeting once a week and talk about things and how things were going there. So this is to illustrate, I think, a little bit in the different roles that a preacher and evangelist might have within a local church. So here's where Paul says to Timothy, I charge you. This is our main passage here tonight. The second time that we've seen this, where Paul says to Timothy, I charge you. In other words, you need to get this. You need to understand what I am saying to you, that even if you can't get to anything else in your ministry, you need to understand this is the most important thing. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, it's essential to do what he's about to say next. Paul has used this kind of language before. When he was speaking to the church in Corinth, when he talked about the gospel, he says, I deliver to you as of first importance. Right? In other words, if you don't understand anything else, I'd like to know about the dinosaurs. I'd like to know about, whatever. People bring up all kinds of stuff, right, they want to know about. This is what's most important. This is of first importance right here, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. Okay? Cut away everything else. If you can get that across, that's of what's the first importance, Paul says, is that gospel message that people need to hear and obey and live. About judgment, Jesus himself in John 5 says that all judgment has been given to the Son. So, what is so important? And it's the next three words in verse 2. Preach the word. Preach the word. That word preach means proclaim, and we'll get a little deeper into that here in a moment. Proclaim the word. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. What does this word do? It reproves, rebukes, and exhorts with complete patience and teaching is the way in which Timothy needs to be preaching the word. This is so important, this verse 2 right here, because this is what not just the preacher or the evangelist of the congregation must do. This is what we all must do as we have all obeyed that gospel. We all understand how essential it is to believe and to live out in our lives. And so each and every moment that God has given us on this earth until he calls us home, we are to be preaching the word. So what is all these things that he's supposed to be doing? Picture yourself driving down a road. Reprove, right? That's where you're going down the highway and you're not paying attention for a second. And suddenly you hear the rumble strips. Oh, what do? You correct it, right? You get back on the road. You get back in the lane. That's reproving. Scripture does that. It points out where we have drifted off just a little bit. We need to get back. Rebuking. That's a don't you do that anymore, right? Scripture will do that to us. In the afternoon class, I used the illustration of dogs and how it is that sometimes, you know, you see something gross. There's a squished frog or some kind of animal dung or something up there on the road, and you just know you're trying to pull the dogs away. You're like, no, get out of there. Don't put your nose in that, right? You're rebuking them. You're coming right down, and the Word of God does that for us, exhorting us, which means to teach. Actually, an ex mean from, and oration, where we get the or right? An oration is a speech. So a speech from, it's a teaching, instruction that comes from the Word of God. And Timothy is to do that with what? Complete patience and teaching. Oh my, that's hard to do, because there's all kinds of challenges and people who have funny ideas, and they don't come to you to say, what does the Word of God say? Like, I know you study the Word of God. What does He say about how I should live my life? Instead, they come with their ideas, and they hear that you're a preacher, and they come with you and say, hey, I've always thought this, and they're looking for you to confirm their crazy idea. They're not looking to learn. And then they get upset when you say, well, that's not what the Bible says. And you're trying to explain to them what the Bible does say. And they just, I don't want to hear it. Right? So they just get out of there. It's hard to work with folks and teach sound doctrine. Acts chapter 6, we can see here, and this is, of course, when we use this passage when we talked about deacons. We saw that there was a problem in the church with the distribution of food to various widows. And it says the 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, it is not right that we should give up preaching the Word of God to serve tables. Now, serving tables is an important job. It needs to be done. There was a problem within the church, and that distribution of food needed to happen, but they put their finger on something that is absolutely essential for the church, and that is the preaching of the Word of God. The ministry of the Word cannot be put aside for anything else. And oftentimes that's what happens, especially in a very small church situation like I was in Plattsburgh, because there's always somebody who needs you to take them on errands. There's somebody that needs you to come and help them tighten a drain. There's somebody that just needs to talk. And all that's good, all that's needed, but we need to be able to minister in the Word. And that's what they say, but we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the Word. So I see preachers and evangelists as being like expert swordsmen. They're the ones who know how to thrust and parry, and they know their footwork, and they're able to go passage to passage and get right to the root of the struggle that the person's having, and they can recall to mind that particular chapter and verse of what might be able to help them out. Have you considered this? And open up to hear, and what do you think God is saying there in this passage? And be able to give the context of what's happening so the person can truly live a better life and be encouraged and may be able to go to heaven one day. It's not a new idea. Ephesians chapter 6, and talking about the armor of God, we see here, stand therefore having all these things. And then finally, that last piece is the offensive weapon. It says the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. So it is a sword. You see little kids and they're waving a stick around, right? It's not great swords play, you know? But then you watch a movie where the actors have been trained by a swordsman, and you're like, wow, that's great swordsmanship. You recognize it when you see it. Same thing with preachers and evangelists. You recognize when they are using the tools correctly, and they're doing it well. And we need that. The church needs to be protected and defended. Hebrews chapter 4 as well speaks about the Word of God this way too. For the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. No creature is hidden from His sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of Him to whom we must give an account. How essential is that? that we're going to be judged by the very word of God, and that God has seen fit within the leadership of his churches to be able to put preachers and evangelists who devote their lives to the ministry of the word and to prayer so that they can help others be able to understand it, apply it to their lives, and lead them to heaven, and hopefully teach others as they go. This is a graphic that appears in the middle of one of the pages of our book that's coming out soon. If you haven't gotten a copy, I heard we're up to 118 out of 200 sold, so you should grab one soon here. But for 36th Street, you see the timeline going across our 100 years. Underneath, we have 18 elders who have served here in that 100 years, the first one starting in 1946. And on the top, we see 9 located preachers. Now, there's a difference between located and transient preachers, something we probably should understand there. In years leading up to the late 40s, there were a lot of transient preachers. And there were some good things about that. It was a time period where you didn't have a lot of social media or anything else. I didn't have a lot of training to understand God's word and so forth. And so transient preachers would come in maybe for a gospel meeting. Maybe they'd stay for a year, maybe just a month, whatever. And they would go around on various churches and work. This was great because they could be true ministers of the word, because they had to stay sound in their doctrine, because word would get out. Hey, so-and-so preached that over at wherever, and we don't want him coming here. That word would get out very quickly. And so there was a check and balance system really in place during those years. Located preachers became necessary. They became very necessary because of the struggles of the world bombarding our families, destroying our families, and really working against in so many ways that a located preacher needed to be somebody who could also minister with the word but help apply it, help individuals and into families and so forth apply the word of God so that they could grow in Christ. They had to know the congregation, where the transient preachers were in and out. So they never really got to know the congregation as well as somebody who spent some time at a work. And so the most notable transient preacher that we had here was Fred Dennis. You probably know that name. He preached over 600 sermons here and baptized and restored countless individuals here. And Angie may be related to Fred Dennis, right? But they are proclaiming and defending the truth of the gospel. These are the true warriors of the church, the ones who know that swordplay and are able to hold to truth and communicate that truth to others so that they want to believe and follow what truth is and not what they've been hearing out in the world that sounds reasonable, but is really a deviation from Scripture. So those things going on. Okay, so preach the truth, right? Why? For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. I'm sure there must have been an application during the first century, and it was certainly volatile there enough, but I think there's a huge application here in the 21st century. What do you think? Do you think this describes our time very well? Where there's so many different ideas out there that nobody even asks if they're true or not. They're true to somebody. They've made it their personal truth. And so they've said, okay, this is now truth. And so how many people can I get to follow my version of truth? And that's really how all these various groups have begun all around us throughout the United States and around the world. They're not enduring sound teaching. They're not listening to truth. There is such a thing as truth. Well, secularism, which of course is very big in our culture right now, they deny the existence of truth. They believe that truth is relative and it's whatever you make it out to be. And there's a certain way of thinking in human secularism that puts a man on the throne rather than God, and therefore we can legislate enough and do whatever we can to try to make mankind's situation better. It's a governmental solution rather than a godly solution. But we're made in God's image, and people know that there is truth. Deep down they do. But they wonder if it can be found. Is truth even out there? And what do Christians do? We keep the truth to ourselves within the walls of our church buildings. We don't allow truth to get out very well at all. We don't speak about it with our neighbors, our co-workers, our friends. We just keep it to ourselves instead of being preachers of the word, evangelists. We got this good news message and we're keeping it to ourselves. And a lot of people are like Pilate, who when Jesus said that he came to be a witness to the truth, and Pilate's like, what is truth? I think Pilate was in that same situation there in John 18, where he just did not understand or know that there was something as certain as truth. It was whatever anybody wanted to make it. And so the people latch onto false ideas, and they call those false ideas truth. They'll just rename whatever false idea it is as truth, and then they expect everybody to follow what their idea is. And here we're sitting on truth. Matthew 24 speaks about them and says that lawlessness will increase, hatred's going to be increasing for us, the love of many will grow cold, that phrase there in verse 12. And that's often a way that we can look out at the church and say that we know the good news, we know what truth is, yet we sit on truth and don't allow that truth to get out. The love that we realize that God has given us and his son on the cross, we keep to ourselves. And that good news isn't shared. Jesus said, though, to one of the churches in Revelation 3, so because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. Doesn't sound very good for us if we continue in that. The last verse of the main passage tonight says, but as for you, Paul speaking to Timothy, as for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering. You mean there's suffering involved with being an evangelist, a preacher? Oh yeah, sometimes. Do the work of an evangelist. Fulfill your ministry. That work of an evangelist, he said, just after he has said in verse 1, or verse 2, preach the word. Preach the word. Do the work of an evangelist. That word in Greek, the prefix EU, which turns into EV in English, means good. And angelos means messenger. Angie thinks that her name is Angel, so that's okay. That's okay. She's an angel. She's really a messenger. She doesn't know it yet. But fulfill your ministry. Preacher, though, is a different word. It's kerak. And it means a herald, a proclaimer. A herald or a proclaimer, a kerak, would be somebody who would stand on the street corner, as Jim Schumann was saying on Sunday morning, and say, hey, here's the latest edict from the king. And he'd be crying out to the town as to what they needed to follow. That was the new law. Or somebody who would go before the king's chariot, right? Make way for the king, make way for the king, right? And John the Baptizer, of course, was that way. And make straight your paths. As Jesus was coming, a proclaimer. And so, evangelistes is his message as glad tidings, one source said. So where the preacher refers to the work of proclaiming the good news, when we use the word evangelist, or one of its forms, we're talking about the message as good or glad tidings that we are putting forth. So we proclaim the good message. We kerak the evangelistes. All right? That's obviously butchering the Greek and English both. Okay, in Acts chapter 21 and verse 8, we see that Philip was called Philip the evangelist. He was one of the seven, we're told, meaning one of the seven from Acts chapter 6 when there was a problem in the distribution of food. Philip was picked. He had to be spiritually minded man in order to serve tables, as we saw. But he was known in that chapter as Philip the Evangelist. It's not a title. They don't call him Evangelist Philip. It's not found on a business card that way. Instead, it's a description of who he was, that he was a proclaimer of good news. That's what he was. 2 Timothy 1 says, "It has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior Christ Jesus, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, for which I was appointed," Paul says, "a preacher, apostle, and teacher." And so he served in those roles. Notice it doesn't say elder. Paul was not married. So what's his work? What's the work of an evangelist or preacher? And we can see it's more than just a ministry of the word. It's using that word to help others apply it to their lives and live it out. It says here in Ephesians 4, "And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers," those five different folks, roles within the church, "to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God." In other words, that once everybody gets there, I'm out of a job. So I don't know how long it'll take for everybody to get there, but that's our goal right here. "Until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children, tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes." See, there's a lot to defend, provide for, and protect the flock as far as ministering in the Word, so that they can recognize the pitfalls that the world is putting out for us, so that people won't fall into them and we can all be led to heaven in the right way. That's one of the roles of an evangelist, a preacher. So here's where we can see some of these words working together. Of course, Luke 2 is where Jesus is being born in Bethlehem. And it says, "And the angel," Angelos, that's where your name comes from, which means messenger, "said to them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good news." Now what's interesting about that is it's one word in Greek. Bring you good news. There's a verb and an object that is being brought, the good news. I bring you good news. It's evangelizomai. Okay, I don't know if I pronounced that right, and hopefully Mike Moss isn't watching. Critique me on my pronunciation of Greek there. "Of great joy that will be for all the people, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord." And Mark 16, 15 and 16, he said to them, "Go into all the world and proclaim," that's karukate, that's the verb form of this, "the gospel," evangelion, good news, right, good message, "to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned." So we can see both of those words being used as both verbs and nouns, to help us understand the role that we are all to play, which is to go into all creation with the good news of God, proclaiming it to everyone who will listen, to lead the lost and also encourage and help the saved stay saved. I'm going to leave you with this thought. Are you preaching the good news? Let's go to God in prayer. Father in heaven, we know that you are a wonderful God who has given us your word that we know to be truth. We know, Lord, that we need to know your word so much better than we do, to study, to be in all the time, for the dangers that bombard us all the time from false ideas and doctrines, the schemes of the world constantly come across to us and they sound so good. And yet, when we compare them to truth, we see how it is that they fall apart and pale in comparison. Help us all to be preachers of the word, evangelists in the way in which we conduct ourselves in living out. And we're so thankful, Lord, that you have given us men who are ministers of the word, but also able to communicate that word to others in such a way that they can apply it to their lives, that the gospel can be obeyed, that faithfulness can be lived out in our lives, so that we can all help each other, lead one another to heaven. We pray, Lord, all of this through your Son, Jesus, who is the master teacher, the Word himself, and it's through him we pray. Amen.
By faith we see the hand of God.